All right, let's get it. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the bullpen. In the bullpen today, we have CEO and actor, The Walking Dead and Slasher, among other things. Mr. Ilan Srulovicz is on the program. Yes, sir. Welcome. How are you?
I'm good, thanks. How are you doing?
Doing quite well. Thank you for being here. We're going to chop it up about police reform. The discussion has resurfaced, obviously, with recent activity that has taken place in Memphis and really some other places. I don't want to presume what you know, believe about police reform, its effectiveness. So if you would submit your proclamation, I would then opine.
Well, I think it's important to start off from the baseline that there are well over 60 million police interactions a year. There are 700,000 police officers. There are negative encounters, but if you look at the really, really terrible ones where, you know, a Tyre Nichols or an unarmed person is shot and killed unlawfully, they're, you know, 10 a year, 15, 20 a year in cases like that that get a lot of attention. And so I do think police reform is necessary. I'm not against police reform. I do think the defund police movement and the general approach to it has been very negative. We've been generalizing and vilifying police in general. And the end result of that, I think, is going to be a decay of police. We're going to inspire people to come into the police force that are not the right kind of people. So I just think the entire approach we're taking right now is wrong.
Ilan, so let me first give you an opportunity to correct yourself. You said in the beginning of your commentary, how many? Again?
Okay, I was talking about unarmed black men, the cases that become very popularized. So if you look,
who gives a damn about the cases that are popularized?
Sir? No, that is the actual number of people per year. It's roughly
lie. 10. That is a lie.
Not a lie.
I would give you an opportunity to correct yourself. So you're saying only how many again?
15 unarmed black men a year, if you look at the average.
No, sir. Damn lie. Come on, man. You didn't even come prepared to have a real discussion.
I did. So tell me what the number is.
Go ahead and give me your source.
The Bureau of Justice.
The Bureau of Justice said only 15 unarmed people of color were killed by the police.
Yes. Tell me what the number is.
Okay. I
will accept whatever number you give
me. Thank you. I appreciate that. Sure. Because that actually pisses me off. The fact that you would think that really 15, and by the way, even if the number is small according to you, that number is big according to those families. You see, we don't weigh crime based on the numbers, even though your numbers are wholly inaccurate. We weigh it based on the community impact. We all agree that a murder has a deeper community impact than, let's say, somebody slapping you in the face. That is the reason the penalty is deeper. That's the reason why the punishment is stiffer, because the impact is greater. But let me go ahead and back up to your original proclamation about 60 million interactions. Medical doctors have significant interactions with civilians on a regular basis. However, their industry is highly regulated. They must have malpractice insurance. And if they engage in negligence, there is a penalty and they have a duty higher than an average person. Meaning, there are things that you can do that if a medical doctor does, it is illegal because they have a higher standard of care.
Sure.
However, for police, it flips the other way. They have a lower standard of responsibility. They are granted immunity in particular cases where everyday citizens would not receive it. And they are protected from civil liability even when they step out of line with their particular job and the administration thereof. But let's get to specifics about the George Floyd Policing and Accountability Act.
Sorry, am I just allowed to respond to some of the things you said? The medical industry has 200,000 to 400,000 people who die every year from medical negligence. A lot of those doctors are protected by the medical community and it is covered up. And by the way, if you want to talk about a systemically racist industry where people are mistreated due to the color of their skin, you would find that more in the medical industry, but we don't see the same kind of attack on the medical industry.
Well, that maybe,
and
well,
wait,
sir,
additionally, I just well, want to
sir, maybe,
to
maybe from, hold on, brother, this is my show. Maybe okay. from somebody else, but we are fair over here. We put the foot where it's supposed to be. We've discussed those same dynamics here about the medical profession, especially how they have led to the death of black women, in particular those who are carrying children, et cetera. So we do those shows right here on this program. But let's go back to the George Floyd Policing and Accountability Act, which is at the genesis of the reform conversation in DC. What do you disagree with? Are you in agreement with the policy reform that over 90% of Americans say must happen. 90% plus of Americans say that police reform is required on some level. What do you disagree with in the George Floyd version of it?
Okay, I mean, there's a lot of other things you said which I want to respond to, but I'll be fair and I'll respond to this question. Number one, qualified immunity, the long-term effect of qualified immunity, getting rid of it, will cause an unlimited amount of frivolous lawsuits against police officers, especially with the atmosphere we live in today.
Let me ask you this question. All right, we got a limited amount of time.
Sure.
You're not saying it's wrong. You're just saying you don't want cops to get sued.
That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that it will cause the decay of the police force and more young black men to die in communities where there's an extreme amount of crime taking place right now, where policing is necessary. I lived in Carson, California. I lived in Harlem, East Harlem. Right. Police are necessary in those communities.
The George Floyd Policing and Accountability Act does not get rid of the police.
It changes the mens rea on qualified immunity to no longer be intent, but to be next. Yes, and that—
Let's chop it up on that. I'm glad you brought it to that. So basically, the police would have the same rules that you have, meaning that in order to be prosecuted for a crime, they would, one, have to form mens rea or not if they're grossly negligent and they engaged in activity that they knew or should have known would lead to the death of another human being. That is the same rule that you are under. That's the same rule that I am under. And you're saying that the police should not be under that rule.
No, that's not what I'm saying.
Tell me what you're saying.
I'm saying that it opens the door to a lot more than just neglectful homicide. It opens the door to any lawsuit, thus inhibiting police from being able to do their job. I don't want them to have a million frivolous lawsuits that would limit the ability to do their job, prevent police from becoming police, screw over the taxpayers completely.
The potential of lawsuit would destroy the industry. You know who defunds the police more than any other entity? Are you aware?
No, you can inform me who defunds the police.
The police. You didn't know that?
I don't even understand the statement.
So let me go ahead and qualify for you properly.
Sure.
When a cop decides to violate the rights of a citizen, when a cop decides to shoot an unarmed person of color, when a cop decides to engage in civil rights violations, the city, the county, sometimes the state, will have to foot the bill. Granted, many of them.
Yes, absolutely. Okay. So, and there's no one who hates a bad cop more than a good cop. I mean,
so who defunds the police more than any other entity? The police do.
So
when you talk about tax dollars, understand what you're saying. You're saying, I'm concerned about tax dollars. If you're concerned about tax dollars,
that means you are concerned about
reform.
I'm concerned about the decay of police, increased homicide that we've been seeing in populations where the police have been defunded and limited. I'm concerned about seeing the ability of police being able to do their job, like taking away chokeholds. I've been teaching close quarter combat my entire life.
Taking away chokeholds.
If you take away people's ability to use techniques like a rear naked choke, which is a safe technique when taught properly, which is a whole other part of police reform that has to be acknowledged. We need more training. We need more monitoring. Who becomes a cop? Start at the root cause and correct people. And then start also celebrating police a little bit more, rebuilding relationships with communities where there's high crime rates so that these interactions become positive.
Why do we need, dear brother, please understand the point of view I'm coming from. Celebrate the police. I don't celebrate watershed management. I don't celebrate the person that deals with a government function of communication or a liaison relationship with parks and recreation. I don't celebrate them per se. I respect the fact they do their jobs well when they do it well, and I don't respect it when they don't.
Okay, so I respect and celebrate our law enforcement, and I celebrate our military, the people who go out and risk their lives every day. I celebrate doctors who go into war zones and help people. I mean, there's a difference in terms of
do
a job where you're putting your life on
the line. Reform required to make sure communities are safer.
I'm saying the reform that has to take place has to start at the root cause, which is rebuilding relationships with communities, which is offering more training to police officers, getting in cops who are
what
actually-
What does the community say?
What's that?
You said that's the solution. What does the community say?
The communities, I've lived in very rough communities. And I'm telling you that deep down in all those communities, having a police presence in Carson, right near Compton, right? All those areas, East Harlem, where I live, that you wanted police around. It is a misconception.
Sir,
that people—
once again, you're conflating something that I'm not posing as
and
a
you
question.
Want police to be able to do their job. If you talk to people they do want strict policing.
Sir, you don't get sued if you do your job properly. Why? Because if the suit is frivolous, it gets kicked out on the administrative dynamic of frivolous lawsuit. If you eliminate this thing called qualified immunity, which, by the way, do you know the origins of qualified immunity? Are you aware?
No, sir.
Okay. Qualified immunity started during the civil rights era. It was magnified so that white police officers, white male police officers, could have their personal assets protected as they bashed in the heads of black children. So that when they sued those cops in federal court, the cops' assets, the home, the car, et cetera, was protected from civil liability. That is the reason you have qualified immunity on steroids in this nation. Remember, understand the origin of a thing, you can understand the nature of a thing. That's number one. Number two, sure. Chicago has been arresting people at record rates for 11 years. Chicago has more cops than they've ever had. Chicago has more budget than they've ever had. Chicago has more authority than they've ever had. They still have more murders than they've ever had. You know why, dear brother? Because you cannot arrest yourself out of socioeconomic dysfunction.
You must address
the root cause, and you cannot hire enough cops to decrease crime. Every statistical point from the CDC to Pew Research shows if you hire more cops, you may decrease crime by 0.001%. Less than 1%. However, if you allocate that funding into preventative work to stop the criminality or address the underlying causes have a 23% opportunity to stop the crime. So why are we not talking about defund the police in agreement then, dear brother? Taking some of that money out of the police department and putting it to the programs that work. That's a public safety model.
I do agree fully that we should be putting money back into communities, 100%. We should be creating opportunities in the communities.
Okay.
And I do believe that if we could solve the problem of increased crime rates in the communities, that you wouldn't need as aggressive policing. But where we are today, it's proven that aggressive policing does reduce homicide. It is a fact. I live
in show me that. Wait a minute. Just show me what that said. Aggressive policing reduces homicide.
Go back to Giuliani's era of policing in New York, which, by the way, I'm not all for. By the way, I'm just saying it is a fact that crime dropped tremendously during his
time. What is that? What does that mean?
Well, I'm not
a person's rights? What do you mean by that?
No, I mean police on the streets in areas where there's high crime rates, arresting people for crimes that they actually commit that don't need to be serious crimes. You see it in things like when we do away with what we've done right now in Los Angeles and California in general. You're seeing an increase in crime there because you're letting people get away with petty crime, which creates an atmosphere that it's okay to get away with more severe crimes. And criminals who start with that will slowly escalate into more severe crimes. And so, yes, it's proven that more aggressive policing, if you arrest people on the street who are doing graffiti, who are doing things that are pickpocketing people or doing rough things, that those people in an environment where there is a higher crime rate will stop doing those things. It has an impact on the crime rate in that environment. But again, I don't think defunding the police has any solution long term other than increasing homicides in neighborhoods.
You're simply talking in circles. So let me bring you back to your own conclusion. Think about this, what you're saying.
Sure.
You just admitted that these programs funded properly, implemented properly, can actually reduce crime.
Yes.
So the defund the police movement says, great, let's take some of the money out of the bloviated police budget that's not working, allocate it to a public safety budget that addresses the underlying reasons for crime in the first place. You have to admit, if your mayor is bragging about hiring more cops, that's nothing to brag about. They're just telling you they got more crime. I want a mayor that can brag about, we have to let some cops go or reassign them because our crime has decreased due to our public safety model. Do you not agree?
I would love it if more money went into communities to create more opportunities and to have after school programs and all these things. I don't think the solution to it is defunding the police. No, I think the long-term
effect of that. Defunding the police was a way to get your attention, to help you understand that policing is not your public safety dynamic. Public safety and policing are different. Policing is a part of it. Public safety is your overall agenda. Stop thinking that giving more money to the police will get you to a place of public safety. All right? All right. I appreciate you being on the show. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Lively debate.
Thank you.